Okay, that's a motion, President Pecky, can I get a second?
Second.
Second, is there any discussion on taking away A from accounting association? Second by Treasurer Day.
Oh, okay.
Sorry about that. No discussion, all's in favor of striking A from report, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, say no. Abstentions, motion passes. President Pecky, do you have further discussion?
No, that's it, Mr. Speaker.
Okay, Treasurer Day.
I'd just like to add under new business, item B, Finance Commission Funding Policies Procedure and Procedure Revisions.
That is a motion, we have second.
Second.
Second by President Pecky, is there any discussion on that amendment? With no further discussion, all's in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, say no. Abstentions, motion passes. Treasurer Day, do you have any?
No.
Okay, Secretary Alder.
Okay, so I'd like to add, what would now be item C under reports, stock minutes of October 24th and November 7th.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Representative Wright, is there any discussion on that amendment? With no further discussion, all's in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, say nay. Abstentions, motion passes. Secretary Alder, do you have any?
Yes, I would also like to add, items B and C under new business.
B, C.
Oh, sorry, B, C.
I live on A, B, C.
Okay.
So the next one would be.
So, okay, so, yeah.
No, she's adding C to reports, Mr. Speaker.
Oh, so, sorry, I love that.
Yep, and then under new business, C and D, I guess?
Yes.
C, Student Organization Policy Revision, and D, PFAC Organization Model Constitution.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
Second by President Pecky. Is there further discussion on that amendment?
Secretary Alder, could you just repeat item C for me?
Item C would be Student Organization Policy Revisions, and item D would be PFAC Organization Model Constitution.
Thank you.
Any further discussion on that amendment? With no further discussion, all's in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, say no. Abstentions, motion passes. Is there any further discussion on the agenda that has amended? With no further discussion, all's in favor of approving the agenda as amended, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, say no. Abstentions, motion passes. We'll now move on to open forum. I believe we have some ready for open forum.
Thanks. Thank you, Speaker. Russ Barr.
Yes, please address the body. And you have 2 minutes to address the body to vote on this.
Members of Parliament, there was an idea in which I know President Pacquiao and Secretary Archer know this. It's called the Rhode Island College Olympic Games Initiative. The idea was to bring together fraternities, sororities, and other student organizations around campus to compete in various sporting events. Not only that it's about competition, it's also about pride, school spirit, and unity. And this initiative, the project that I've been working on since this past summer, and with all of us working together, including the Green Council and all the other organizations that are recognized by student government, we'll be able to make this dream a reality. I received an email from the president of ASA, Sean Brelsford. And President Brelsford explained to me that this initiative will bind the RIC community together more, which that'll be all of us here and all the campus. And school spirit will increase as the initiative goes along by about like 20 to 30% over the next 2 years. According to the initiative charter, all student organizations that are willing to participate in the Olympic Games will have to have their official team colors in two color and three color combinations. Except the exception to this rule, the groups are exempt to this rule are fraternities and sororities because their official colors are already in front of the national bodies. And if we can all work together, and if student government decides to pass this initiative, we'll begin the process of unifying the entire campus. With the help and support of faculty, staff, and college administration. And so, as you as you decide whether to pass it or not, please keep in mind that it will not only will benefit student government, but it will benefit the entire student body, including all the academic constituencies, Residence Halls, which are outside of Sanchez is part of, and the rest of the campus, commuters, faculty, staff, administration.
Mr. Rose?
And that's all I gotta say, and thank you for your time, and have a good night.
Okay, thank you for coming to address the body. Thank you. We are gonna move on to officer announcements. Oh wait, actually, is anyone here else for open forum? Anyone for open forum, anyone for open forum? All right, we move on to officer announcements.
Thanks, well, guys, I'm gonna make my state of the student body, so hold on while I get my phone on, please. I don't have my bodyguards here to lift it for me, so, no, to do it by myself, thank you. I just need this, thank you. It's, I'm actually glad that Mr. Rose came in, because unification is what I'm gonna talk about tonight, so, here it is. Well, I have never had so much trouble writing something in my life. Perhaps it is because there is no need to research beforehand or use the proper citations. Maybe it's because I've never had to deliver an address like this before. But I feel that the most difficult part of undertaking this endeavor is saying what you feel and sticking by it. Here's my attempt to do just that. We all know that in life, not everything can be perfect, although it seems as though this sentiment is amplified as we reach college. The grade you got on that paper you worked on for weeks isn't what you may have deserved. You always lose your debit card before payday, and it always feels as though there's never truly enough time in the day. And these instances seem to pile up upon one another until we lose sight of that small, flickering light at the end of the tunnel. No matter how optimistic a select few of us may be, we are enthralled within our own lives, mulling about between classes and work, and never bothering to raise our head and speak to our neighbors. While the reality of the situation may not truly be this bleak, the future will be if we, as the student government of Rhode Island College, sit back and do nothing. It is tradition that when any president is delivering an address to their constituents, to speak on the major qualms of that base. For many administrations, past executive councils have worn this campus's most primary concerns on their lapels as a giant blinking red letter A. Apathy has been plaguing this campus for generations of students, and it is high time that it comes to an end. Apathy is at the crux of every other chief concern on this campus, whether it is the condition of our campus, our advising system, or parking, just to name a few. If we do not voice our concerns, things will not get changed. Everything that my executive council and I will enact or change this year will have a direct impact on ending apathy for good, but we simply cannot do it alone. What I have encountered in my short time as president of student community government is this: we are all hypocrites. Now, this may sound very harsh, but usually the truth is not easy to take. And I am not just talking about SCG. I am talking about every student on this campus. We expect each other to be able to relate to one another because we all know what it's like to be busy. But when that method is tested, do we really measure up? We expect people to come to our events, yet we don't attend theirs. We expect people to care about our progress, about our strides, yet we do not ask about their own personal triumphs. We expect our fellow students to drop their priorities and support us, yet we do little to support them. I know what I am saying may be a sweeping generalization, and I am certainly not saying that we as a body are not hard workers, but within such a statement is a very small kernel of truth. How do we expect other students to care about our organizations when we can barely work together ourselves? When did student organizations become about competition and monopoly and less about fun and productivity? Whenever this transition happened was when apathy was born on this campus. But this is how we can combat it together. And speaking to student parliament, you are the voice of the students. You are the most direct representation of a student aside from them visiting our chambers in person like Mr. Rose has done. Remember that. Meet with your constituencies, listen to them, and enact change. They signed your petition for a reason. Do not displace their trust. Greet them when you see them in passing and build a foundation for a sturdy Rhode Island College community. To student organizations and student leaders, you are the tangible manifestation of intrigue and growth on this campus. Continue to promote yourselves, but also remember to promote each other. Co-sponsor events. Use your budgets wisely and remember to stay positive. If you are proud of your work, others will take notice. However, make sure you commit only to things that you have time for. Continue to do what you are doing and be patient for the time being. To the administration and faculty, Thank you for respecting us as your equals. College is a time for growth. We know that we might not always make the most informed decisions, but they are always well-intentioned. If you are willing, please continue to be bystanders and know that we will reach out to you when we need help. And finally, to the student body as a whole, you are the most important component of this apathy-killing campaign. You are the stakeholders in our corporation. The future is up to you. Tell me what you want, and I will use every effort and resource I have to make sure that it gets done. I am here because I want to listen to what you have to say, and I want to help. Academics are very important to me. They should be to everybody. We are, above all, here as students. It is a wonderful opportunity to be granted a leadership position on this campus. It opens doors and grants that individual with a multitude of other opportunities. We can't let that inflate our egos. Be down to earth, be humble, be part of a team when you need to be, and be the leader that you can be when it is most necessary, and know your limits. There are many things on the agenda tonight that myself and my executive council are asking you to give very careful thought. While they are only policy changes tonight, these policies affect every single student and every single organization on this campus. Our aim is to make SCG Incorporated more accessible, more open, and more welcoming to students. So while it may seem like a tedious chore, I implore you to take it very seriously. As I mentioned before, you are the most direct representation of your constituency. Use your voice. For those students on campus who think that all SCG has to offer is a disgruntled conversation, I urge you to reconsider. During the past few administrations, SCG has fought for better food in Donovan, better ways to advertise your organizations, feminine hygiene products, a campus-wide shuttle, an annual spring concert or event, and a homecoming event, various renovations, and fostered the growth of over 10 new student organizations this semester alone. We will continue to plow forward with the same fervor and continue to fight for what you deem necessary. Yes, we've made mistakes here and there, but we are just like you, students who are hungry for change. This is only the beginning. We need to come together as a group of active, informed adults who strive for a better Rhode Island college. Apathy is squashed when we as a student body begin working with and supporting one another. Apathy is defeated when we as a student body work towards a common goal. When I took office last June, I vowed that I would leave this campus better than when I inherited it. With your help, we can achieve this goal. Thank you. Another announcement. Because I made Julia Palmieri the chair of the SEC, I now have another non-student parliament seat open on that committee. So if you know someone that is not on this body that would be interested in joining that committee, please just direct them to me and have them fill out a committee application form so I can make that appointment at the next meeting. And let's see. There is a survey online to pick which genre you'd like to hear. I don't know if Julia's changed it, but please keep checking online for that link. Another announcement, my email is working again, so feel free to email me at president@scg.edu. And there's a couple things that I'll be mentioning in my issues of parliament members that I want someone to bring to the table that's not me to author a resolution that I'll need help with. So once I say those, come see me after the meeting, and that concludes my announcements, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you for your announcement, President Beckett. We'll move on to Vice President Hillary Costa.
I don't know how to follow up the student body address. So very short today, new parliament members, as President Beckett has said, Ashley Goldberg for the sophomore class of 2015. And just today, we finished validating a petition the Elections Commission for the Weber Hall seat, so that is now filled, and we should see her after Thanksgiving break. I have a PR meeting on November 19th, an Elections Commission meeting on November 26th, and I'm working on submitting ads to marketing to get ourselves visible and be a presence back on the screens around campus and the Student Union again. Also, when you get a chance, don't do it now because you should all be paying attention to Parliament, but the mobile version of our website is up and running and it's in the stages of near completion. So if you type in scg.ric.edu on your phones, the mobile version will show up. It has our logo, the president's address underneath, and then when you press the menu square at the top right corner of the site, it drops down and it shows options for the homepage, the campus map, the members, and today's activities, where it features the upcoming meetings that we have. So make sure you give that a look, and that's all of my announcements, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, Vice President Hillary Costa. We're going to move on to Secretary Gianna Auger.
Okay, so a couple things. My next roundtable meeting is next Wednesday from 12:30 to 2. I know it's the day before Thanksgiving, but we're having it then, so we'll see how the participation for that goes, how the turnout goes. But it'll be here in this room, Student Union 407, and the topic is about advertising and promoting your student organization. Letters went out to the student orgs over a week ago, so everyone got them. The holiday party is coming along great. We just got the candy in today, so look for the candy. We've also been planning the store bees, and constitutions are coming in every week. Tonight is actually the first night that there hasn't been a constitution on the agenda, but two constitutions went to SOC today, so you'll see them at the next meeting. And I'm looking for another parliament seat on SOC and one more non-parliament seat on SOC. So if anyone's interested or knows someone, let them know. And that's all.
Thank you, Secretary Gianna Auger. We're going to move on to the Treasurer, Jordan Day, for our moment.
November 13th, I sent out the monthly budget reports for all the student organizations. So if you're part of a student organization, it'll be in your mailbox down at the Baltimore Info Center. If you don't have some mailbox, please speak to someone in student activities, and they'll arrange one for you. I currently have two parliament seats and one non-parliament seat open, so if you know anybody who's interested, please let me know. Budget hearing notifications went out from our office today, so it's just telling you the process and the deadlines and the dates. And I have a meeting with Dr. Pitt on Friday at 12:30 in order to discuss academic advising. If anybody's interested in going to that meeting with me, President Peggy can't make it because she has work. Oh, you'll be in Canada. Never mind, I lied. She'll be in Montreal. But if anybody is available and does want to go, then please let me know. I'd like to have anybody's input who's experienced difficulties with academic advising. And with that, I have nothing else to say. Thank you.
Thank you. I have a few leaves tonight. Dear Mr. Speaker, I'm requesting a late leave for 8 p.m. for tonight's parliament meeting due to my Monday night class meeting. He has an exam. This is from Representative Terry. Can we get a motion?
Motion.
Second.
Motion by Representative Sanchez, second by Secretary Auger. Any discussion on this leave? No further discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say no. Any abstentions? Motion passes. We're going to move on to discussion, say all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say no, abstentions, motion passes. As from Representative Diaz, dear Speaker, members of Parliament, I would like to request a leave from tonight's meeting since the school is functioning on Monday schedule, so it's my job, I couldn't get anyone to come for me. I wish you all a productive meeting and a very happy Thanksgiving if I'm seeing for next week, and thank you, Representative Diaz. Can I get a motion? Motion from Representative Sanchez, second from Secretary Yager. Is there any discussion on this leave? No further discussion, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say no, abstention, motion passes. And I have no further announcements. We're gonna move on to Deputy Speaker Ryan Bethel.
Okay, I currently have a couple parliament seats open for conditioning services. If any of the new members would like to join that, please let me know. And if anybody has anybody interested in joining conditioning services as a non-parliament seat, I also have a lot of seats open. So just see me after the meeting if you have any of that. Also, at the next meeting, I'll have some progress on the lot C resolution. Leading up to the next meeting, I'm gonna have a meeting to try to gather some data concerning lot C. So I'll have that for you next meeting.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker Ryan. We're gonna move on to reports A, Finance Commission minutes on November 7, 2012. Treasurer Jordan Day.
I just ask that these minutes be accepted with unanimous consent.
Is there any opposition to that? No opposition, those minutes will be accepted with unanimous consent. Now we are gonna move on to B, Historical Allocation Report, Jordan Day.
So since Mr. Santeri isn't here, I'll be presenting this by myself. Rob basically took numbers from this fall semester, fall of 2011, fall of 2010, and compiled information in regards to funding and how much money had been allocated from the Finance Commission. As you can see, there's a drastic difference from each semester, well, drastic difference. In fall 2012, meaning this semester, we've only allocated $62,750.52. When I say only, it's because for fall 2011, we allocated $98,516.56, and in fall 2010, we allocated $98,631.75. And you can see from operating budgets that we either have a lot more organizations starting or we have a lot more organizations failing to complete the budget process. And I think it's because we have had a more strict guideline for budgeting and when budget hearings happen, so we're trying to be as close as possible and following policy strictly. However, personally, I see growth in our operating budgets, but everywhere else we've decreased, which I think is, well, especially other, we've decreased. As far as conferences, we've allocated a lot more for conferences. We do have one conference that will be reverting at the end of the semester, since that conference was not attended. However, that's the amount of money that we approved for allocations this semester. It's just kind of to put things in perspective for you guys so you know where we stand as far as financially our history, and that this is a vast improvement where we are now from where we've been, and that we're on the right track to where we need to be. So I'm gonna consistently remind you meeting after meeting where we need to go and where we need to be in the future, and that's why getting everybody ready for the budgeting process is really important, and I want you guys to keep that in mind as well. I've worked on that with the Finance Commission, and even today we had a really productive meeting. It was a long meeting, but a productive meeting nonetheless. And we're making progress slowly but surely, and we're being very thoughtful of the things that we do, and I think that that reflects in the report that Rob put together for us. So with that, I just ask that this report be accepted with unanimous consent.
Is there any opposition to that request? No opposition, those minutes are going to be accepted with unanimous consent. We are now going to move on to C, Student Organization Committee minutes of October 24, 2012. Secretary John Walker.
I just ask that these minutes be accepted with unanimous consent.
Is there any opposition to that request? No opposition, those minutes are accepted with unanimous consent.
Was that just one clarification? Was that just
on to new business A.
Mm-hmm.
ASL interpretive policy. President Becker.
Okay, guys. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. So this is a draft. This is not final. This is not a draft. This has not been looked at by Disability Services. I probably would like to motion for a 10-minute discussion on your feedback, if we even need 10 minutes for it. What I have is kind of the basic skeleton of what I wanted to get across, but obviously nothing is set in stone, so I really wanted to know what your suggestions were. I don't think I have to read it. It's pretty straightforward. Basically, the concern is that the student, based on, you know, my experience so far, we've had a student who self-identified and requested services for ABC meetings. The protocol for requesting an ASL interpreter is a 2-week turnaround that we have to submit to the state, and the state provides us with, through the service, with an interpreter. Fortunately, that student will just be retaining their academic advisor when he attends those ABC meetings, but obviously that was just a rare situation. We don't have a policy for it, and so this is the first attempt. I would at some point like Dr. Kane to look at this. He was out of the office this week, so he didn't get to look at it, and I would like the Director of Disability Services to look at it. But if you could just do me a favor and read it right now and look at, you know, some of the things that are on it and let me know what you think, what needs to be changed, what needs to be added, that would be very helpful to me. I just want a complete discussion. I want this, the first draft, mostly to be the final draft at some point. So just take a look, and if you have any questions. Right now, I specifically was told that students must self-identify themselves. So right now I have it that they need to submit their request for services to the Disability Service Center, and then come to SCG, and the president would cross-reference with Disability Services, and the president would personally request those services through the state, and on the student's behalf. What else can I do? It would be helpful to have a list of dates to the meetings that the student would like to attend, or the events, just so we can request all the dates at once instead of having to go every 2 weeks and say, I need an interpreter in 2 weeks, I need an interpreter in 2 weeks, I need an interpreter in 2 weeks. So then we have it on record. Obviously, the list of dates, there's nothing I can do if there's no dates in front of me. The fourth thing is the funding for it. I mean, that I'm open to suggestion with that, but I don't have a line item in my budget right now for it. So that's just my thoughts and Jordan's feedback on number four. And then if the student is absent or needs to cancel the services for any meeting, I felt it was appropriate that they roll over to the next semester, and that's just one less that anybody has to pay for. So there's probably a list right now, and I want to hear you guys' feedback. So what's going on?
Okay, Representative Sanchez.
I'm not sure if I understood you. You said they have to come into SCG?
Yeah, so there's no way that I can know unless they come to me. Last time, thankfully, the Director of Disability Services called me, but I don't really feel like that's her responsibility every time. I feel like they should come to both places. If you have a different suggestion, I'm open to that. That was the first thing I thought.
Well, that could just cause a problem.
Why?
Because, Trent, are you going to have an interpreter there?
To come into the office? Oh, that's true.
Yeah.
I mean, honestly, Rob, this is the first time I ever did anything like this, so I'm open to suggestions.
That's what I was thinking, like, through email or something.
Mm-hmm.
But
so through
if
email?
They're going to come in person, you have to consider that
so
option.
Would you suggest that they go to Disability Services first, and then the director emails the president of student government?
No, that the person
just emails me. Okay.
You can ask them to come in, but the situation is if they come in, they might need an interpreter.
Right. See, because my concern was that they have to self-identify to me, you know what I mean? And then the second thing was, I really do have to let Disability Services know, you know what I mean? It's kind of like a dual recognition thing. So I want to make sure I covered all my bases. So email would be better. And the only thing is, I want to have resources, like a printout at some point, available for this kind of process. And if they don't know about it through Disability Services first, they won't know to even email me.
You could also put a little link on the website, the SCG website. Sure, this was a service that was put on their website for no questions asked.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Do you want to pass the floor to Representative
Sure.
I just was going to comment on number one. Said student must self-identify.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, the student will follow the same protocol he's requesting as an interpreter academic.
Mm-hmm.
The protocol, the way it works, which maybe you are or not student, like any other student with a disability, would have met Ms. Rossi. She's the director of the service. At that time, she would work with that student and fill an accommodations form out. Ms. Rossi would not be calling and contacting each professor academically, nor would she any other organization. So in that sense, that student has documentation. That documentation would be presented to a professor who, for at least since 2011 in the fall, has to sign off on that. So I would suggest that perhaps you would follow the same procedure, that when this student or any other student that requires this service
mm-hmm.
would come to Disability Services with that same form, and you would sign off on it, that you're aware of it, it's documented, and then you're talking about things about wanting to know dates and times,
mm-hmm.
just like a professor would want to, you'd want to know a class schedule. But I would think, in truth, the real procedure is the student is then given that form to go to a professor, and it would be the same with you.
I didn't know how it worked.
Yeah, that's part of it.
No, I didn't. I didn't know the specifics because when we encountered, you know, this one student so far requesting the services, Dr. Kane told me that Rob was kind enough to inform us that he needed the help, but Dr. Kane told me he couldn't do that for him. So that's why that's
confusing. Exactly. The only reason I'm clarifying is there's no reason you wouldn't know it.
Okay.
But when it goes off, it's not just that a student receives the form. The student would meet with every professor or any entity here.
Mm-hmm.
And since the fall of 2011, I believe, that professor or staff member has to sign at that time.
Okay.
If that's acknowledging that they've received it, if they need clarification, they contact Ms. Rossi, and it would work in that
okay.
way.
Okay.
Just so that
no,
I think if we followed the same procedure, it would make sense. The other way, too, is that's confidentiality.
Mm-hmm.
I'd prefer it not really, Rob, be an email piece of that kind. None of that correspondence goes through email through Disability Services regarding
okay.
person's needs. I think, but your point is clear, someone would have to be with the student if there was a necessary, if an interpreter was needed at that time. But if it's a matter of dropping a form off for student government to sign off on, that probably wouldn't be necessary.
No, that most likely not.
Okay, just wanted to clarify.
Because the only problem I had was that, you know, like the student may not know that on August 1st, 2012, he wants to join ABC or something, you know what I mean? So it's kind of something that he might have to investigate after Student Activities Day, and then what protocol do I use from there? So your information is very helpful.
And that's why it's on record and she has those forms. It's
mm-hmm.
like if a student dropped a course and added another one.
Right.
They might not know on August 28th that they were going
exactly.
to be taking Bio 101 because
okay.
they were going to take Geology 101.
Thank you.
Representative Dunning, that was your remarks. Thank you for those. you have nothing to.
Oh no, I'm just
okay.
feedback.
We have Treasurer Danos.
This is more now a question for I guess both. Now, would the organization leaders be the person signing off on these basically an affidavit saying that they are using these services, correct? Or would it be one of us?
I think it would have to be either me or both, because
okay.
then I would be liable. You know
okay.
what I mean?
So
like it's kind of like
right.
some combination. That's my
okay.
point.
That was just more of a question. I don't know how it works for academics, so maybe as professors or Robbie might have experience, so I don't know.
Well, I can answer to that. Like say you
okay,
needed
go this way and then that.
Say you needed I've had students with not complete deafness, very commonly, where they need an FM system brought in.
Mm-hmm.
I'm brought to the form and it will say that an FM system would be put in place. Ms. Rossi, who's the Director of Disability Services, would then be making those arrangements or working and coordinating with whatever department or in your case entity.
Okay.
So she would be also a resource to you on that.
That's some clarification, thank you. Okay.
I
gotta get to Rob and then I'll pass the floor to
Representative Santos, did you wanna
exactly as Professor Gunning stated. At the beginning of the semester or a week prior, you receive your letter states what assistance you request. You take it to your professor, they sign it, you bring it back to Disability Services. The professors normally do not. Some request a copy, some do not. Upon request, they make a full copy themselves. What I would recommend, that it does not have to be you personally. You can designate somebody that responsibility to accept them, sign form, and acknowledge it, whether it's in the computer system or however you wish to put it.
Might have to be the president. I think that's where we're trying to clarify.
But that, as long as it's the president and the organization president, I wouldn't have an issue with that.
As long as it's designated person, whoever you choose to designate president or vice president, it doesn't matter. Whoever's designated, they'll get the copy. I'd recommend make a copy for your records, sign it, give them back, they'll deliver it to disability services. They do them automatically at the beginning of every semester. They start roughly 2 weeks before the school begins with the letters. But it is a simple formula they can type up at any time. They'll probably make a little template specifically for this, because you do not need to know all the information, everything they need. All you need to know is
specifically what we need to provide
regarding the ASL interpreter.
All right.
So they'll probably make a little template just for that. They can print it up, fill it up by hand, give it to them, they bring it up.
Cool. Okay. Thanks for your student input. I appreciate that. Mr. Paolo, he seems to be aging. Can I pass the phone to him?
He's next on the list.
Okay, then I'm not going to pass the phone to you.
Oh, good. My next on the list.
It was more, I just wanted to have general questions on how it operates for academics. But the only other thing I wanted to ask was, has anybody else that's in a student organization had anybody identify themselves that needs disability services? Other than Mr. Paolucci, because apparently he has had somebody identify themselves. So that's why I was just, okay, nobody else has, okay, cool, I'm done.
Okay, Representative Paolucci.
Okay, I like the fact that we're bringing up Carrie Rossi. I think she's the expert that the college has hired to do the job, so we always look to the experts. I like Mr. Sanchez, and I believe he's knowledgeable, but I think you're limiting yourself by saying it's an interpreter policy, that it should be open to all students with any disability for any event, that what's the legal obligation that the college has, and that's what you want to represent yourself. So I don't know where the policy would sit within student governance policies, because you have funding policies, you have bylaws and things like that. I don't know where you're going to put
that.
Well,
I'm just calling it a policy for the sake of calling it something
okay.
Right now, to be honest with you.
It's a stock.
Ideally, I would really like this to be, like Rob said, a template in our office that someone can pick up and fill out
mm-hmm.
kind of thing, but it matches disability services.
Okay.
And so then we're all on the same page.
Okay. I think, though, that you need to direct it towards any student with a disability that wants to attend an event or a meeting that student government is somehow putting on and opening it that way. I think Carrie can give us a lot of input on what is our legal obligation and the process that she uses and the timelines that she uses. I'll just give you a for instance. We're all going to Montreal Friday. We have a student that needs some services. He's requested it through Carrie. We have a student that's volunteering. She went through a course with Carrie. She's coming on the trip with us. She's doing it as a community service project for herself, for her class. It's been approved by the college. She worked with me and Carrie, and I'm the advisor for the group. And we keep the student element out for that confidentiality. What's happening, I kind of keep the students in the loop in the organization for what they need to know, but that's where it should end. It's similar to the academic world. We deal with Carrie and the faculty, and we keep all the other students in the classroom kind of out of the loop. They don't need to really know. And I think it's the same way you should treat it for student organizations. You have advisors for all student organizations. You have an advisor for student government. And we go that route until we need to inform other students. I think that's the kind of the protocol. I have an issue with number four.
Mm-hmm.
I think you have a legal obligation. I don't think you have the ability to limit the number of times a student to request a service. So I think to put limitations on something, I think you have a war to deal with.
Yeah,
I
no,
think,
I
right?
mean,
I'm
probably
think,
not going to leave it in there. It's
right.
just kind
I think
of a basic thing.
Mr. Nickerson is going to do the grammatical correction.
Oh, it's
so
honestly
I'm going to leave that to him because I think
he's going close to final. So just
right.
Don't even waste your time.
But I think starting with Carrie is the answer. I think having something is great,
mm-hmm.
but I think you're putting some limitations on.
Yeah, no,
we should open it up.
I'm definitely
going
to talk to her. I talked to her very briefly about the one situation that I brought up, and so I'll be calling her again with all these suggestions. So.
Good.
Okay.
Thank
you. Are you
I have three people left on the list. If there's anything really legitimate concerning tonight, I feel it could be saved to just President Pecky in private. But Secretary Auger?
I pass.
Okay.
She answered my question.
Representative Sanchez, anything you feel is more immediate tonight? Or?
Yeah. What did you call
me? Representative Sanchez.
Sanchez.
Sorry, if there was any confusion.
I just wanted to let you know, I can't read this personally, but I'll read it. I'll bring it to the computer at this time,
okay.
So I can read it.
Just, can you email me?
And then I'll let you
know. Okay, thank you, that'd be helpful.
I wish I could give you more of
No, it's okay, it's all right. I didn't know.
Thank you. Representative Carlson, is there anything?
Sorry, Representative Sanchez. Just quickly touching base on what Mr. Pleasantries had said, the student who is utilizing a guide for the Montreal trip originally approached me asking if someone could do it, and I wasn't quite sure where to go with this. We directed him to disability services, and then we eventually came upon the foundation that we would have another student for him. He originally kind of came to me as the one running the event, and I wasn't really sure. I knew to direct him to disability services, but I wasn't really sure what to do.
Yeah, and that's the very reason why we need something in our office in writing that they can just access. So thank you for sharing that. That's why we need this.
You also have something, too?
I just was going to suggest following up on my ALG. Might it be considered that you approve the offices could be with Ms. Rossi?
Yeah, no, I was definitely thinking about
prior to you bringing the policy again.
Absolutely.
Getting
no, I was
her
going
feedback,
to.
Or perhaps having her come to student comment, which I'm sure she'd be happy to do, which maybe she could clarify for everyone. The ADA isn't straightforward if it's not something we can deal with. So.
Vice President Costa?
On the essay marketing ads, and I think Ms. Palin may be able to answer this for me, there's a disclaimer at the bottom about students with disabilities who want to attend the events that they're supposed to contact the sponsoring organization. What is the organization supposed to do from there as far as helping them? Or is that only for accessibility?
That's what we're deciding.
Is that what we're deciding on?
Well, no, it's not, but it's a valid question.
Representative Perry, what should you answer?
Again, I'm not the expert. Usually it says something, I believe it says something like, and it's been longstanding for years we've been putting it.
It's
part of
the disability services policy.
Right, it says something to the effect that reasonable accommodations. And now, and then we have to decide with disability services what is reasonable for that specific event or that trip that we're providing. You know, is it, you know, that we need to have a bus with a lift on it, and we need to know that in advance, so when we order the bus, we have that capability for that student when we sell that ticket.
All right.
So it's usually with trips that we do. It's not so much geared towards some of the events that we do or the meetings that we do, and I think that's, we're kind of branching out to, you know, student organization meetings, this, something like this event.
No, I just wanted to see what action was taken.
Okay, Representative
Nickerson. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I don't have much to say about the policy itself because I think it's just really heading in the right direction, but I just wanted to make a suggestion that perhaps we could see if we could arrange for somebody from Disability Services to come to a meeting with us to sit down and really talk about it, so that way a group of students who are all student leaders, okay, about awesome student leaders, shameless plug, just as a way for almost like diversity training in a way, because it's so important that we don't think of it from the perspective of what do we have to do? It's more like, how can we help? And so if we're all on the same page, and I think that, you know, a lot of us want to be, you know, lawyers, politicians, teachers, we're going to be experiencing this in the classroom, on the pulpit, and in the real world. It's very good to just have that sort of training and awareness so that way we can spread on the word much more easily, be confident, as well as nail the language, because they're trained experts in this subject. And I think we just all benefit sort of as student leaders as a whole, because then when it comes time for things like budget times or when we have mandatory president treasurer meetings, it could even be a quick presentation and just get the word out to all the organizations so everyone's on the same page. But it's more like hearing it from the original source would really alleviate a lot of the questions. questions, because the legal language with disability services is pretty straightforward, but the how-to to get there can be a little bit tangled. It's something I've been working on a lot in one of my classes, so I'm familiar with that. It's a lot more complicated than this, but it can be a lot more simple once you nail the nuts and bolts. So I think like sitting down with the people in disability services and really hashing it out, it would be hard to have a policy and a procedure that would be hard to argue with, because it would be in line with the law and the college's current practices.
I'm just going to comment on yours regarding that disclaimer. Generally, when that's happening in any event, whether it's through any department, or let's say it would be the Sherlock Center on Disabilities or the PD department or whatever the sponsoring group is, they would provide those accommodations. So, for instance, if somebody needs an interpreter that's going to be attending the event, it's an actual department or whatever entity on campus that is sponsoring the event that is usually providing that, purchasing that service.
Yeah, I was just thinking from a student organization's perspective.
Well, again, that's why I got a little bit murky here.
Yeah.
Because it was a student club and student activity, not a department.
Mm-hmm.
And with no further comments, I'm assuming to Austin. We move on to the funding policies and procedures amendments by Treasurer Gumbay.
Sorry about that. Rob, I know that you don't have this digitally, and I have access to it in my email. Would you like me to send it to you so you can view it on your computer?
Yes, please.
Okay. So I'm going to let President Pecchia speak on it, and then when necessary, I'll jump in.
All right. Okay. So Jordan has been very hard at work making some changes to the funding policies, because there are just several discrepancies. A lot of it, a majority of it, was housekeeping, so a lot of it she wants to specify, but it's like spelling and making things consistent. So there were places where it said SDG treasurer, and then it said treasurer of SDG, just for fluidity. Anybody knows that you just write the same thing. But I think really what we'd like to discuss tonight, I think we're going to motion to approve all the changes, but the main discussion tonight you'll find on page 11 of 19, and you'll also find on page 16 of 19, specifically a discussion about revenue. This was a little bit in conjunction with the discussion we had about the conference policy last week, I believe, and the changes we made, again, for consistency and fluidity, we had to change our funding policies so that it was consistent with the changes that you guys helped us make last week. Please read it. Please think about it while we're discussing. Please voice your concerns. We'd really like to get this done tonight, or at least have some positive feedback from constructive criticism, I guess, is what we'll talk about. But if there's any clarification you need, I'm sure there will be, because we're not all the financial wizards that Ms. Jordan Day is. So feel free at any time to raise your card and ask us a question and stop discussion. But honestly, if we feel that discussion is going circular, I will tell you now I have no problem motioning for a 2-2 roll. You don't have to approve it, just gonna tell you I'm gonna motion it. So pass the floor to Jordan. What would you like to tell us, Ms. Day?
So any of the changes?
Jordan, I actually have some good input. First of all, I'm gonna give you a motion, and President, I get second.
Thank you.
I think how I would like to run this meeting is to go along change by each change. Ask by unanimous consent. If it is any objection to it, we'll make a formal motion in a second, and then we'll discuss whatever amendment that is not under unanimous consent. Is that cool?
Okay.
All right.
Just because there was, just speaking, just for clarification, just because there were so many little grammatical changes,
yeah,
just one bigger content.
Just want to work at it one at a time.
All right. So I'll basically start by outlining everything for you guys. Any changes that are there are highlighted in brackets. Right now the formatting is a little weird because there are brackets, parentheses, bold, italicized, everything is already in here. So I'm gonna go through as many changes as I can spot, because it's kind of hard to spot brackets when you're not necessarily looking for them. On page 2 of 19, I added subpoint 4 under general operating procedures. Organizations are eligible to request allocations and reallocations. Allocation requests are submitted when an organization needs additional funds in the operating budget. Friendly amendment to say in there.
Is that accepted as friendly? Okay, we'll proceed.
Reallocation requests are submitted when the funds within the operating budget will be moved into different line items.
Then the point below that, that I altered, and this is with Finance Commission's approval. Mind you, all these policies were approved today in the finance, at the Finance Commission. Allocations, reallocations, and emergency allocations are available 3 business days after final approval. It did not specify, however, it did not specify in the original policy the way it was stated how things were approved. It said, it was a non-statement. It just kind of said information, but it didn't make a decision. So this statement just basically declares how long you have until you have access to your funds. It's something that there is questions that I have, and that I'll bring up to Parliament about that briefly.
Number 11, you have something.
Sorry, thank you. Number 11, sorry, I appreciate that, Speaker Escobar. In that sentence, it said no disbursements will be allowed until each treasurer and president have gone to you. It said the general treasurer's meeting, and for consistency's sake, it said president treasurer's meeting at the top. I wanted to move president treasurer's meeting to the bottom again in order to make sure that it's consistent language, because I don't refer to anything as the general treasurer's meeting anymore. And that hasn't been referred to in a long time.
Okay, is that for only, is all the change for page 2?
Yep. Yes.
Is there any objection to page 2 and all these 3 changes? No objection. All right, those are all going to be approved as amended.
Thank you.
So we're going to move on to any other changes that you're talking
about. Nothing in budgeting procedures, but in budget classifications. Oh, sorry, I apologize.
No problem.
Page 3 of 19, the first paragraph, last sentence, instead of saying treasurer of SCG, I asked that it be say that, no, that's supposed to be like that. That's
oh, okay.
Sorry, guys, minor cabo with Secretary Auger. Instead of saying the treasurer of SCG, we asked that it say SCG treasurer for consistency's sake.
Okay, is that accepted? Unanimous consent? Let's change for page 3.
Thank you.
Okay, with no objection, that will be.
On page 4 of 19, in budget classification, you guys will be seeing some of this tonight. When requesting a budget, the annual budget hearings, the lines will be classified into 3 categories. The 3 is in brackets because it said 2, and we've had 3 for 4 years, the 4 years that I've been on the Finance Commission. So I just wanted to save us some grammatical effort. In the parentheses, two lines below, it says refer to. It said the student organization's classification, club classification policy. That is the student organization policy that will hopefully be approved tonight. And I also amended on point 3, item B, all funds allocated instead of all monies allocated.
Okay, is this all accepted? Will unanimous consent? And I keep going, no objection. To page 5?
Nothing on there.
Nothing on there?
Page 6, though.
Page 6, okay.
I have another simple change. Point on subpoint 1 under purchases, it says the SCG treasurer instead of the treasurer of SCG. That's the only change on page 6.
Okay, any objections to that? I'm going to approve it with unanimous consent. Anything on page 7, Treasurer?
No, sir. Oh, sorry, guys. I'm really sorry. It says to withdraw funds from an organization's budget funded by SCG. It said monies, I changed it to funds to clarify.
Any objections to that?
Sorry, apparently under contracts, I also had in subpoint 1 the SCG treasurer, and instead of saying treasurer, of SCG. Oh, okay, sorry. Yes, please, thank you. Underfunding.
So wait, that was the other change too, right? For okay.
Mr. Speaker, is it possible to just make that change throughout the document? Because that's really tedious.
Under funding of charity events, subpoint 2, I put 100% of the fundraising monies given will be considered excess revenue. Before it said revenue, and with the policy that we're hopefully passing today, if we don't, it's totally cool. We broke down revenue into specific categories to help everybody out. And I believe that is the only change made on page 8.
Okay, and is that accepted? We can have consent.
On page 9, under records, I'm going to read the whole policy out loud. All organizations must keep ledgers and may periodically check their balances with the SCG treasurer. The ledgers shall be changed, broken down into line items versus categories by the Finance Commission. The organization should keep a copy of change the approved budget, originally said signed budget request. Signed doesn't necessarily mean it's been approved. Approved means that Finance Commission has approved it or Student Parliament has approved it during budget hearing times. So approved budget request so as to have reference to what exactly was granted. Organizations may not switch between different line items. It used to say categories. Organizations may switch within categories by presenting, and I struck language. It's discussing reallocations. It said, or mailing two copies of the reallocation request to the Finance Commission and the S&G Treasurer. We don't follow the policy that two copies need to be mailed in at Finance. We require representation for all of our requests. Then I have the S&G Treasurer shall check the request and present it to the Finance Commission for approval or disapproval. And then I relocated any student activity fee paying member may appeal the decision of the S&G Treasurer to the Finance Commission.
Okay, are all those changes accepted? We have this consent the page. No objection, we move on. Page 10.
No changes on page 10.
Okay, page 11. All
right. Line 500 excess revenue policy, I reorganized the entire policy. There's different wording in the policy. I am prepared for discussion and we will motion for a 2-2 rule and I'm adhering to that right now. All organizations have the ability to make revenue through fundraising events, donations, ads revenue, etc. Organizations should explore the use of revenue prior to requesting additional allocations from the Finance Commission. It is recommended that revenue accumulated in line 500 should be used for capital improvements, promotions, and expanding the organization's operating budget. The Finance Commission has the right to amend or deny any reallocation requests from line 500. And just so everybody knows, line 500 is now a category. So when we refer to categories, there are also lines. It's line 260, line 100, line 110, just for clarification. If an organization wishes to use funds from line 501 and line 503, and just so you guys can reference on page 16 of the funding policies, we now have breakdown for 500 revenue. It says 501 excess revenue, 502 conference revenue, and 503 ads revenue. So if an organization wishes to use funds from line 501 and 503 to supplement anticipated revenue for a conference, the organization is only entitled to use 50% of the combined current balance of line 501 and line 503 at the time the conference request is submitted. If any organization has the intention for each conference attending to fundraise, example, sell ads, tickets, etc., with tickets, candy, etc., with the purpose of covering conference anticipated revenue, said revenue must be deposited in line 502 by the president or treasurer of the organization. All excess revenue deposited into line 500 will be allowed to carry forward into future fiscal years. Excess revenue will be accumulated once funds spent out of line 239 are paid back. In the event that an organization accumulates revenue valued upon their approved operating budget, the organization must appear before the Finance Commission for an audit. And this is something that's longstanding within the policy. This isn't anything new, just to clarify for that paragraph. In order to use funds from line 500, organizations must reallocate into the line item. Friendly amendment, it should say they wish to use.
Any objections to the friendly amendment? Then we shall proceed.
Reallocations may be made by the student community government incorporated treasurer as long as the line item is currently open. If the line item is not currently open, the reallocation request must be submitted to the Finance Commission. Should an organization's budget be reverted or the organization goes defunct, the organization's excess revenue will remain in their account for 3 semesters. After 3 semesters, the funds will revert back to the general fund. If an organization does not have funds left in the previous year's operating budget and has a past due bill, it must be paid out of line 500 excess revenue, and there are no further changes on page 11 and 19.
Are all changes on page 11 except the unanimous consent?
No.
Okay. So anyone to introduce discussion?
Speaker Escobar, could you just state for the body what 2-2 rule means? Representative Dean just asked for an amendment.
I did a motion officially.
Oh, okay, because he had just asked me, I didn't know.
The 2-2 rule means that everyone on Parliament will have 2 times to speak on this issue for 2 minutes each. Is that the rule?
Yeah.
Okay. Any discussion on page 11 of the funding policies? Raise your cards. Any other discussion? I really do want to get through the rest of the policies. If you feel like you're going to talk, let me know. Okay. Let me start with President Beckett.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. So before we get into the discussion, I'd just like everybody to know that we brought this to Finance today. We actually made a lot of changes to the third paragraph with members of the Finance Commission, and feel free to speak, put yourself on the list. We'd like to hear you. And it was approved at the end of the meeting with unanimous consent. So that being said, this is the thinking behind what Jordan and I kind of thought in changing this policy. So,
excuse me, President Specky, I just need to correct something.
Absolutely.
I need a motion and second to approve.
Oh, sure, sorry.
So I'm.
Oh, I thought you said that we did that from us.
No, this is for this amendment. So we have a motion and a second. I'm going to give it to Treasurer Baines, President Becky. Sorry to interrupt.
It's okay.
Point of information, do we have to vote to approve? Just out of curiosity.
We didn't vote the motion, guys. We didn't vote to approve. Not yet.
Yeah, we do have to vote to approve.
Okay.
I just wanted to clarify that we were just stating that if we needed to.
If we needed to, we would. If the discussion gets redundant, that's just going to happen.
But I just see two other people on this, so let's keep going.
So, okay, so as I was saying, the thought behind this, you saw the state of the general fund last week. You saw the changes we made last week. 62%, correct me if I'm wrong, Ms. Day, of our allocations from finance this semester alone have been towards conferences.
I think it's 49.
49. It's still a significant number. So, what we're saying here is that there's a trickle-down effect. There's a trickle-down effect. A lot of organizations have the ability to use revenue for the conference funding. We are concerned with that. We are very concerned with that because sometimes the tradition has been to use all of the revenue. But what happens when the next administration needs something for capital improvement, they can only afford it through revenue, and now they can't have it because they spent all their money on a conference that was decided by the previous administration. That's part of it. Another part of it is that we're trying to encourage fiscal responsibility, wise spending, reallocating within your own budget. We're not saying don't spend revenue on a conference. That is not what we're saying. We are saying if you would like to fundraise for your conference, go for it. You just have to tell me it goes in line item 502 for conference funds. And when you come to finance and you say I want to go on a conference, that's where it's going to come out of. Any club has the ability to create a line item 500 for revenue and make revenue for that club. We encourage it. At one point on this campus, every single club fundraised for something, whether they sold candy bars, whether they sold t-shirts, whether it was just an example. XIN has stuff at the Rough Stone. They charge sometimes for admission. That is fundraising. That is okay. But what we're saying is that if you want to do that, if you want to sell ads, if you want to fundraise so that it defrays the cost for your members, Feel free. But if you do not have that ability to fundraise, if you choose not to fundraise and you just like to use line item 501 as just what we're calling it right now, excess revenue, you only have access to 50% of those funds as a safety net for your organization for the next year. So that's basically the relationship between changing this specifically, more or less, the paragraph 3 and the changes you'll see on page, 16 of 19? In tandem. That's what the idea here is. So, I mean, we're open to feedback, but again, this was approved unanimously by members of finance today. So, I mean, that says a lot to me. 100% of them agreed with it. We had a long discussion. Jordan and I have been working on this for at least, I don't know how many weeks, and we sat down for at least 2 hours yesterday and sat there and said, how can we make this simple for them? How can we get this so that new people coming in will understand what our goals are? So, I mean, obviously I'm in favor of this because I wrote it. I think it's important that, you know, as adults we learn how to handle our money, especially to something like if you're the president and CEO of an organization, you can't just be like, oh, let's spend all our money. Let's just get rid of it. The next group won't need any of it. So, I guess that's all I have to say for now, Mr. Speaker. I'm interested to see what other people have to say.
Thank you. We're going to move on to Treasurer Day.
So, I'm not going to bring up the conversation in finance today. It's unnecessary. The changes are in front of you. But what I am going to bring up is the purpose behind it, and I think President Pegia kind of highlighted it, but I have my own reasons for wanting to have made this change. As many of you know, there are groups that come for capital improvements, come for additional funds. I was between funds and monies, and I hate the word monies. Come for additional funds for events, bookcases, refrigerators, water coolers, desks, chairs, etc., printers, all sorts of things. And capital improvements happen to be one of our biggest costs. They fall into the other category. Also, conferences happen to be one of our biggest costs. So I can tell you right now that there's one organization here on campus that brings over $20,000 in every semester consistently.
That's
funny. There's one organization right now that has $3,000 in their revenue account. Actually, that's probably two or three. Those organizations, I want them to use that money to go towards the things that are going to overall complete and assist in the purpose of their organization. If you have an office upstairs and you want a bookcase so you can buy books for literature for your organization in order to help better your purpose, I would want you to be able to, it's making us codependent and working with each other. It's saying that we want you to make excess revenue on your events, and we want you to be able to use that money on things that are going to better your organization. Conferences do better your organization, and that's why we didn't want to say no revenue can go towards conferences, because that's not fair. You guys work for that money, and that's, or not even you guys, organizations work for that money, and they deserve to have access to that money. But my concern is that not all the time are all the student organization members benefiting from all the revenue being spent on conferences. They would benefit if that money was spent on computers, if it was spent on bookcases, if it was spent on memberships to national associations. That would better those people. That would better those individuals for the entire group. It has nothing to do with the conference. I want you to go to the conference. I want you to get more out of it. That's what makes you good leaders. That's why I encourage people to go on student community government conferences, because it makes us good leaders. But the thing is, we can't rely on revenue all the time. We have to build a dependency on ourselves as individuals and on the system. We can't say, I'll give an example, because this is the example I used in the finance meeting today. If the Anchor newspaper wanted to go on a conference, and I wholeheartedly endorse it, and they said, all right, every person is obligated to sell an ad to cover their portion of anticipated revenue from the conference, that would be conference revenue, and I'd have no problem with that happening. You have as many ads going towards the paper as possible. You can even have people join in and bring in a big ad. That's totally cool, as long as it's dictated by the president or treasurer of the organization, which it states in the policy that the president or treasurer has to deposit and state why it's being deposited or which line it's being deposited into, so we have a clear understanding of where the money's coming from. That way, it's fundraising. It's not bringing in, I know for a fact that people on this body have personally worked in ad sales or sales in general, and it's a hard field to be in. I know I have to sell student government to people all the time. I don't get money from it, but I try. not really. I thought that was lighthearted. Apparently not. But the purpose of this overall is to make sure that the Finance Commission and the organizations can be working with each other to better their overall purpose. As much as I agree with going on conferences, I can't say that using $3,000, the best example I have is the number that's in my head right now, $3,005 and how many cents was it, Jen, for programming? They don't have the ability to have, well, they could have revenue, but they don't have any, but it's $3,005 is the best example I have right now. If they had enough revenue to cover that, we'd say, all right, you can only cover 50% of that. That way, it leaves them a little bit leeway if they want to buy a fridge, if they want to buy a table, if they want to buy a new whiteboard, if they want to buy new things that are going to better their organization and enhance maybe their office, enhance. If they wanted to buy sweatshirts out of Line 500, I'd totally be going to go for it. It's in the clothing policy. But we're saying that finance can't continue to allocate funds from the general fund all the time. We can't be dependent on it all the time. Right now, I think we're at the place where we can change and make things better, and that's why I'm putting this policy forward. I wouldn't do it to stunt anybody's growth, and I would never want that to happen. And if you feel that way, vote the policy down. I'm totally cool with it. But I'm here because I think that I'm doing an accurate representation of what other students would do. I know that there's this conference going on this weekend that students entirely fundraise for. That's $5,000 that they fundraise for. It's possible to do more than just collect revenue from whatever you're doing. It's possible to charge for your events and make a difference. It's possible to charge for the speakers that come here. And I honestly think that it would be a better use of all the organization's time if they worked together. And if every organization sent a letter to me and said, hey, I want to do this, and I think that this would be a
helpful in the funding policies, I would take it under consideration, but nobody's giving me a guideline, so I'm working with what I've had, and this is what I've got. So with that, I close my remarks, because I'm long-winded.
Thank you, Chair Pate. We're going to move on to Representative Martin.
Okay, I want to state for the record right now that my fingerprints are on that change of line 501 and 503. I want to make that very clear to everybody. But after consideration, I don't know if I can once again support that. I just want to put that right out there. Because personally, I was an ad manager of the Anchor newspaper, and the main purpose of selling over the summer for our orientation issue was to help us pay for our conference in Chicago. And to have that, those ads revenues would go under the line 503, I believe. One of those lines that you could only go for 50% unless other people were selling ads, of course. But I don't think I can support my own amendment to this to have revenues that you can't use. You can only use up to 50% of your revenues for a conference, because if an organization finds out that, you know, they have a good amount of revenues and they can only use 50%, and they're only a little bit under that amount, you know, they can't use any more of their revenues, and they have that revenue sitting there. Because most organizations are not going to spend, you know, so much of it that they're going to put themselves in a huge hole. I just wanted to speak on that. I'll let others speak. And if I have anything more to say, I'll raise the card. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Portland. We're going to move on to our comptroller, Representative Santeri.
Thank you, Speaker Escobar. Sorry, guys. I would say, but I'd say just for record, like Mr. Porter, my fingerprints are on this, especially for a lot of policies changed for me today. And I think that, in general, I think that with Treasury Day update, the policies is a great move, and I agree with actually both of them. But as I made my reservations known in the meeting today about 500. Just to throw some things out there. I said in the Finance Commission meeting today that I had my reservations personally about voting for the changes to revenue policy. And just looking at it real quick, because what we talked about was actually a very spirited discussion. We actually talked for probably close to an hour about it, if I recall correctly, in Finance today. But, and one of the things I pointed out, I don't know if it's still relevant or not, but what we were talking about was fiscal responsibility and us being adults and all that kind of rhetoric. And I think that most clubs in general, except you always have your exceptions to the rules that are going to do whatever no matter what. But I think most clubs in the first place would be fiscally responsible with their revenue. If only because if they're not fiscally responsible with their budget, then their membership is not going to be none too pleased with them, on top of the fact that if you look at the last line, the second paragraph, it says the Finance Commission has the right to amend and deny any reallocation request of line 500. So the Finance Commission already has the right to say to an organization that come to the Finance Commission for a conference, say the I'll make up a club, the Treasurer's Club. Say the Treasurer's Club comes to a Finance Commission meeting and say, we would like to go on a conference. We have $6,000 in our, let's say we have $5,000 in our revenue. We want to use $3,000. Conference, which is over 50%. And the whole thing is that when the Finance Commission is reviewing their conference, they have the right to deny, any requests from line 500. I know the policy right now is
policy states that any allocation from any line item within the budget has to be under $150 and the treasurer approves it or can approve or deny. If it's excess revenue, though, the treasurer is the only person who sees it if it's going into an open line item. So I can elaborate on that more when it's my turn to speak.
Yeah, I won't go into too further discussion about that. But I just wanted to say that. I won't talk too long because I don't want to keep this conversation to be running around in circles and talking about that. Well, thank you, Speaker President.
Okay. We move on to Vice President Costa.
I just wanted to echo the sentiments of President Pecchia and Jordan, Treasurer Day. I've had some people on the body express reservations to me about these new changes, but I think of it in a different way, and as I said, echoing their sentiments. I think of it as a snowball effect, because if you're taking the money that you earn in ads or something of that nature, you're taking it and you invest it into your organization. And when you invest into your organization, you make yourself more appealing. And when you become more, you know, I'm not saying any organization right now is more appealing, but if you, you know, raise the bar, when you raise the bar, your recruitment boosts. And I know that organizations have trouble with recruitment here on campus. So when you boost recruitment, you boost word of mouth around campus. So that means people hear about your organization. And when you have people hear about your organization, you get more involvement. And when you have this increased involvement, you hold these fundraisers, and when you hold these fundraisers, that's more of a reach that you have to the community here on campus to get people to this fundraiser, to raise money for, you know, whatever conference you may want to go on. So I just wanted to offer a different way of thinking about this, instead of the two sides that are here. I kind of wanted to offer this kind of ground to it. But those are all my remarks. I hope I wasn't repetitive anyway. Thank you, Speaker.
To elaborate on the reallocation or comment, reallocations when submitted through excess revenue, they are only approved by the Treasurer of Student Community Government if the line item is open. And that was brought up today by actually Representative Dean, correct? And I said my concern is that that's actually a loophole for organizations. Because organizations can, treasurers have personal bias. I'm not gonna lie, we all do. I'm not part of any organization, but I do have a really harsh look at all organizations and some more than others. I'm not gonna lie, why not? But when it comes to reallocations and you submit that reallocation, if it's coming from revenue, it can be any amount of money going into an open line item. And it was brought up that any reallocations under $150, but if the conference line item is already open, there is no system of checks on the treasurer. There is a system of checks only between the organization and the treasurer, but not between the treasurer and the finance commission. So if you want to change that policy that all reallocation requests have to be seen by the finance commission, unless it's under $150, then go ahead. But I think it's gonna delay productivity, and that's what I said earlier. But the other thing is, when we were in finance, and I don't want to discuss what was brought up in finance because we resolved the issue, but when it was brought up in finance, I asked every member who had a dissenting opinion if they had another alternative, and they said no. So I offered an alternative, and I changed the line items, and I moved it around so everybody could make a team effort and work together and compromise, and I'm all about compromise because I don't feel like I need to be a stick in the mud. I feel like I need to help every other organization be better. I'm not here for me at the end of the day. I'm here for everybody else. That's what I'm here for, at large. Melodramatic, sorry. I thought that I came up with a solution, and I hear a lot of I think, but I don't hear I know. And I'm providing an I know that I think, I know that I have, I'm sorry. Now that's actually comedic value. I know what's being done. I know what's being spent. I know what's being brought in. I'm the one giving you guys the reports. I've always felt this way, that we should trust the people who made the decisions in the first place. And although we have two people here who are unsure about their decision, I'm willing to sit there and make it better. But who's gonna offer me something better? I want to see something better. If you give me something better, I will do it. But prove it to me. Come to me. Talk to me. Offer me options, because I don't have any other than this. I'm done.
Okay, thank you. Move on to Representative Tomlouma.
Yes, my issue with this just seems redundant in a way. The split, basically, you know, at will, basically, because this is not student activity fee money that's coming in. This is revenue. So to categorize it in three separate categories, I mean, it's anyone can do it any way they want. You know, it just seems a little redundant because it's. But basically, what I'm trying to say is that we already have a check and balance system, because in order to reallocate this money out of Life Fund 500 into an active line item, you have to go through the treasurer or the government or through the finance commission. I just don't see the point of having more checks and balances when maybe a solution to this would be wording. It is highly recommended that this money be used for, you know, capital, promotional, stuff like that. But I don't see how it's necessary to split into three line items when it's all coming in as one, you know, non-student activity fee money.
Is that what you want? Okay, we're gonna move on to President Becky.
Thank you. Well, Representative Lima says that it's redundant and he doesn't see the point, but I'll give you a point. So basically, honestly, all of this is kind of like a revolving door kind of for us. This is what we discussed in finance. People are getting frustrated. This is a revolving door conversation. Basically, everything I feel like depends on working kind of like in sync. Everything depends on something else. So, where do some of the conference funding come from? Where does it come from? It comes from our general fund. But where does everybody else's budget come from? Our general fund. Jordan said that we might not have enough next semester for club budgets. And why is that? Because we've spent so much on conferences. So in changing this policy, it is a safeguard against depleting our general fund. There were so many angry people last year that we only had $1,000 left to reallocate because we didn't have enough to give them. I mean, you have the historical allocation report. It's right there in front of you. That's why. That is why. And if we keep allocating the way we have, we won't have enough to give to those students, and they will continue to be mad. And like Vice President Costa said, she said it beautifully. It makes you less appealing as an organization. Who's gonna wanna join you if you say, well, I only have $50, we can't do anything this semester because we have no money for it, because student government didn't give us money. Well, it's because we didn't have it, because of this. I mean, obviously there's other reasons, but this is a very large portion of why we don't have those funds to give those clubs in the spring. So I feel like it's not, Mr. Lima's fine to have his own opinion. My opinion is that it's not redundant and it's absolutely necessary. And again, there is no alternative suggestion. I respect all the dissenting opinions, I really do, because it helps create a healthy discussion. But what is the idea? What are you gonna change? Where are we gonna change it to? Give me language to change it right now. That's why we have this discussion. Mr. Nickerson is famous for coming up with language in a discussion like this on the fly. Nobody has given us an alternative. Nobody. So, I mean, I just don't, you say you don't like it, well, tell me why you don't like it and give me an alternative, just like Treasurer Day said. And it just goes back to what I said in my State of the Student Body tonight, is just apathy. We can't just think about the present. We can't. We have to think about future administrations and future students that will come to this college. We have over 80 organizations that show up on Student Activities Day. Everybody's all abuzz, I want to join X, Y, and Z organization. And then come 3 weeks later, they never joined and they don't want to be part of it anymore. There's no retention. I'm not saying all of it has to do with the money, but a good portion of it has to do with the operating budget of every club. And if we can't provide that, then what are we doing? We're doing something wrong and it needs to be addressed. I have notes here, I'm sorry. And just as a clarification, because again, I think this is getting lost in translation, we're not saying that you can only use 50% of what we're proposing 50% of 501 and 503. We're saying that if you specifically as an organization would like to fundraise for a conference, come to finance and say, we raised $3,000. We want it to go into 502 and we want it to be applied to this conference this semester. If you haven't fundraised, what we are saying is in 501 excess revenue, if you have $6,000, you can only use $3,000. And sorry, you gotta pay the rest like everybody else has to pay for a conference. I've never gone on a conference for free ever. We resigned our own conference because it was $400 a piece after the 50% that we provided. It's just unreasonable. Bring it down. We would have, I mean, if we had time, we would have fundraised for ourselves, but we have other things to do. We can't be thinking about ourselves. We are here for the students. So, I mean, I guess, Mr. Speaker, that's all I have to say on the issue.
Thank you, President.
I can't move on to inquiry. I'm sorry to interrupt.
Yes.
This is just out of curiosity, because just from my observations, but out of the 31,100 conferences, how much of that was allocated to the anchor for the fall conference?
I don't have specific numbers. It has to be under 8,000.
Right.
It's because Rob will know more specifics. But it was only the actual deposit that you put into the port, correct? Or was it the total request?
It was the deposit. I didn't include the money that would be back from anticipated revenue.
So it would be under $8,000.
Alrighty, I was just wondering.
It's about 7,000 something.
I know that the number seems inflated, but they usually do a spring conference.
Mm-hmm.
So I was just thinking, I thought of that as maybe that being one of the many factors causing such a big boost in it, that's all.
Okay.
And one of many, not the only.
That's it. That's it. I'm not allowed comment if it's based on the...
It's just a clarification one.
Okay.
The Andrews conference was included in there. The just generally about the conferences, numbers for that, went to direct back, then $7,000 less for both the total and whatever number is for the total and for the percentage conferences, the Washington percentage conferences will go down from there.
All right. Just wondering.
Okay, we're gonna move on to Secretary Jayna Auger for comments on this.
Okay, so really quick, everyone's just like Treasurer Day said, everyone's saying I think. And like I think that orgs would be responsible with their revenue, but the truth is, from being on the Finance Commission last year and from seeing the allocations that we get, from seeing the everything that gets spent on revenue, we know what orgs spend their revenue on. And we know that sometimes the revenue is just drained from conferences, just absolutely drained. And then they come to, the same organizations come to finance for capital improvements, which they could have spent part of their revenue on. T-shirts, sweatshirts, anything like that, clothing, you name it, frisbees. Anything that to promote the organization or capital improvements that could have been spent out of revenue instead of coming to finance and asking for an allocation from finance. So, everyone has their own opinion. Everyone's entitled to their own opinion. Not everyone, but some people don't agree with this policy. What's the other solution? I think that this change is absolutely necessary. I think that it's necessary for the state of organizations in the future, and that's all I have to say.
Okay, thank you, Secretary Jayna Auger. We're gonna move on to our staff representative, Mark Kalinchuk.
Phew, finally. Good, 35 minutes. And I'm gonna take the clock off the wall. For some of the newer students on the board, the staff, the non-students that are on the board, usually we don't vote on financial issues, so we kind of stay out of the argument. But I wanna get into the argument just a little bit. I looked at the policy and I looked at the date, and it said April 25th, 2012 was the last revision, and it just happens to be like some, you know, next semester we're already talking about another revision where we've had policies that have gone, you know, decades and we don't change them, and then all of a sudden we're changing. So I have a question, and it sounds like there's a negative effect on some organizations, and that's, I'd like to know from Miriam, or put Miriam on the spot. What organizations would have a negative effect with the change in the policy? Mary can answer that for me.
Very much the media organizations that bring in ad revenue. Certain organizations that, if they did not go through the budget process and are starting with an operating budget this year, if they do not specifically allocate
my question. There's obviously a negative effect on this policy for some student organizations. It's not all, and so there's a limit. And I'm trying to identify for the student body what, so you guys can make a judgment on whether you want to change this policy or not. There's obviously a negative effect on some student organizations. And let's try and identify, you know, let's talk about the elephant in the room. What are the organizations that this policy would have a negative effect on? Can we identify them? There's members of some of those organizations on the body. Let's put the cards out on the table.
Okay.
Okay? And I'm asking if Mary can do that. And if not, maybe Mr. Escobar could do that, given that he was past president and this policy was in effect back in April of 2012, when you were president.
Would you like me to speak honestly?
I would like everybody to speak honestly, and I'm not asking for the treasurer or the president to speak on that. I think we've heard from them for about 20 minutes or so each, and I'm asking, put the cards on the table. What are the organizations specifically that we're talking about that would have a negative effect on changing the policy so the students can make some judgment that they can vote? Either one of you, given that you're past president and that was the last time this policy was revised, and Mary is if Sally was here, I'd be asking Sally, but she's not, so I could have to ask Mary.
Yeah. I'm guessing you're just looking for like a little bit of a history, kind of to recant the past.
I think I know the history. I think they don't know the
history. They don't know the history. So yeah, I mean, basically what you're, to anyone that doesn't know what's really going on, or anyone that doesn't really know the history, being president of student government, you obviously have organizations vying to you about, you know, allocation of money, because that's the main point of being president. And I'm pretty sure, Representative Dean, if you ever look through the budgets, you've probably seen many budgets, many operating budgets, and a lot of them are large. Like, some of them are large, and a lot of them are very, you know, normal. About $5 to maybe $10,000 if they're a good organization. Our larger budgets come from the media center. And, you know, those organizations are meant to really make revenue in a way because they're so large. They're you have a radio station, you have a television station, and you have a newspaper. And what any of those organizations would do out in the real world outside of college, they would try to get advertisements. So you have, obviously tonight, you have people from those respective organizations trying to defend how they want to use their revenue. And you have, you know, the people in government. It's kind of like politics 101, I guess, or government 101, in a small atmosphere. And you have people that's just looking at the raw numbers, and they're trying to come up with a policy that will actually protect not only student community government, but protect other student organizations so we can actually continue to fund organizations for their conferences. The Media Center, until this year, has had the opportunity to basically go free because their organizations are geared to make revenue. This is why they're large. This is why we pay a staff, that's why they have a staff operating budget. I'm pretty sure the Anchor has a $40,000 staff. I may be wrong, I'm just throwing numbers out there. There's large staff numbers for each organization. And we pay them because we want them to be productive. We actually want them to make money. And when we allow them to really use that money based on for conferences, they're still gonna ask the government for more money because they wanna improve either for computers. I remember 1 year they asked them, their computers were on dropping down, so they're asking for money for that. T-shirts to promote the organization. Anchor would ask for, you know, certain money to just pay for staff members. Anchor TV, during my term, during my time as student leader, they basically grew under that term. There's a lot of money we've had to invest in Anchor TV. And this policy is not really an anti-Media Center policy because we support our Media Center groups. Obviously, we support Anchor TV every night because they come over here to videotape our meetings. But it's more just about fiscal responsibility. So obviously, you're going to get the people who are in opposition, which I'm a little bit confused of because, and during the committee, it should have been debated upon there. That's where the real work should have been done. So that's a little frustrating, I guess, on the part of the government standpoint. But and you have people just looking at numbers. So I don't know if I explained it the best way that I could, but
right,
you have
you know, your interest. You have your special interest groups, and they're just trying to come up with what they best.
I want to identify the organizations that would be affected by the change in the policy.
It's just that
and we obviously have, you know, if you want to raise your hand, you're a member of one of those three organizations, Anchor, Rick TV, or
Anchor TV.
Rick TV, Anchor TV, and the radio station, the Anchor, and those three organizations. If you're a member, obviously there's some of those people that are involved in that, those organizations, that there would be an effect on them.
Yeah, and the reason why it's an effect on them, because these organizations, again, as we reiterate, these organizations, again, are geared to make revenue. We're not asking for Lasso to make revenue just to throw an organization. We're just asking to hopefully throw events and get people to be a part of that student organization. You're not going to ask for many student organizations to make revenue, because they're just not geared to do that. We're not; those members are not getting paid, and those members' sole purpose is just to provide events for that campus. The media center, on the other hand, they have the tools to make money. So I think what President Vecchia and Treasurer Day are trying to do is just to have finance, you know, analyze that money, and just try to hope that capital improvements, or even expansions with the staff, or anything that organization wants to see fit. They want it to come out of their revenue instead of come out of the general fund. Because those organizations that can't make revenue, they're relying on what? The general fund. So that's basically what I guess President Vecchia and Treasurer Day is trying to protect. General fund. And if you've seen last week, this policy should be a no-brainer, because if you've seen last week, it's becoming dangerously low. And when I was president, I wish that as president, I was a little bit stricter when coming to finance funding policies. But again, that's very difficult, because it's politics, and you have people protecting different interest groups. So, Representative Perlouse, is that good?
Good.
Okay.
Can I just say, in the past, it's been you could use 100% of the revenue. Okay. So you got to know, we went from using 100% to 50%, they're asking for 50. I'd ask the question, was it ever anything in between 50 and 100 presented to finance?
We're open to suggestion. That's the number we came up with.
I'm just asking the question.
No.
Thank you. That's it. Next.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to take back the gavel, and I'm going to represent the next on the list.
I would just like to start off by saying that I'm probably the least biased speaker about this issue so far, because I'm not on any organizations or anything like that. I'm just trying to protect the interest of my constituents, which is a freshman class. And just like to say that I completely agree with President Vecchia's and Treasurer Day's, I don't know what to call it, but they say they want fiscal responsibility and all that, but I just don't agree with the way in which you're going about it, with the 50%, because I see that as sort of an unnecessary handicap to any organization that really strives to raise money, not through fundraising, but say the ad manager or something like that. They worked really hard to get enough revenue to go to a conference. I think that the 50% is sort of just a handicap, and I think that it would be possible for an organization to spend 70% of the revenue, that's just a random number, on a conference and still be fiscally responsible while doing so. So I think that the 50% is kind of, it's not really based on enough facts that I know of to really be implemented. And so I think that the sole responsibility to make sure that these organizations are being fiscally responsible lies on the Finance Commission and Treasurer Day. And I'd just like to say that I believe that it's our duty to place our votes in what we believe is right, and not because we know a person. I'd just like to say that just a couple of weeks ago, there was a girl over here, and I was in the Finance Commission, and she sits right next to me in class, and I voted no for her allocation. And it was really awkward going into class the next day, sit next to her after I voted no on a thing, but you know, in the bottom of my heart, I knew that I voted for what I thought was right, and what I thought was best for my freshman class, and to protect the general fund, which is in dire straits right now, apparently. But yeah, I completely agree with, you know, advocating fundraising and fiscal responsibility, but I just don't see this as a fit solution to do so. My only really solution would be to cut that out and let the responsibility lie with the Finance Commission and the Treasurer. Because those are the people that we elected or appointed to have that responsibility. And I don't think that it should be just from a policy. Because I think it would be possible, like I said, for any amount of revenue to be used and still be fiscally responsible. Like for accountants. That's all I said.
Okay, thank you for your comments, Representative Dean. We're going to move on to Alumni Representative Barry Nickerson.
Thank you so much, Mr. Speaker. I used to run the anchor, so I'm trying so hard not to be biased, because I really want to look at it from an impartial standpoint, because I think that there are great ideas here. I personally disagree with the methodology, but I can't vote on financial matters, so I'm just going to try to analyze it from an impartial perspective. So I think that the biggest gist that I'm getting here is that we're having organizations that have revenue but are asking for money for things like capital improvements but aren't using their revenue to fund those capital improvements. But the way I perceive it is that capital improvements covers depreciation, which is a cost, and the purpose of the SAG operating budget is it's an operating budget, it's supposed to cover costs. So I feel like it's almost big brotherish to expect organizations to use their revenue in certain ways. But at the same time, not being a part of those organizations, I'm not sure if they need that helping hand or not, but maybe they do. I don't have the numbers in front of me. Treasurer Day does, so she knows all about that. I also kind of see this as a bit of an ethical dilemma where our values are coming into play, because here we're choosing whether or not SDG is going to have oversight on revenue, which is money that organizations make on their own using their own means, which has nothing to do with the student activity fee. But if that money is being misused and then there's abuse of the general fund as a result, then there is sort of a need. So I think we're trying to get at whether or not that need is as active as is perceived, or if there's truly something here that we need to stomp out now, because sooner or later organizations are going to be running into trouble that are doing things right because somebody's doing things shady. That being said, I do strongly feel that I don't know about any of everybody else, but I wasn't at the last meeting, and I feel like this was kind of, we're looking for another solution, but this was sprung up on us at like 7 o'clock on a Wednesday night. So as much as I agree with the idea, I don't think we're going to come up with the alternative solution tonight on the fly that everyone's going to agree with. So with that, I'm going to yield the floor to Eddie Taylor, because I think he has a couple of ideas.
Okay. Well, I take issue with the fact, I have my own feelings about this, but I'm not going to talk about that. I have issue that when I came in, I had no idea this was going to be on the table, and I wish that this was given to me at least a day in advance, so that way I had to read over and really be educated. I'm not like a fiscal specialist or anything like that. So what I would like to do is motion the table, so that way we can talk about this next meeting, so that way we have a chance to look over the writing and make a better informed decision. So I can motion the table.
We have a motion to the table.
Can he do that when we're going to pass the floor?
Yes.
Can I just check?
Yeah. There's no. We have a motion to the table by Representative Taylor. We have a second from Representative Sanchez. All those in favor of, there is no discussion on the motion to the table. All those in favor of motion to the table, say aye. Please raise your hands too.
Aye.
I say no. This is my question.
Okay. That's all right. And everyone, I'll say no.
No, actually, no. All
right, we have a
I changed my mind.
Okay. And abstentions on the motion on the table?
I abstain.
Okay, we have abstain from Representative Bancor.
Point of parliamentary inquiry. Does that cease discussion on the rest of the policy or just this page?
Yes, we are tabling the policy to the next parliament meeting.
Okay, cool.
Okay, and motion and the policy is tabled. And just to clarify, the reason why I want to raise everyone's hand is because sometimes when I say, everyone say, hey, or whatever, there's just a so it's hard to tell, who's actually in favor for or what. Some people just like to over yell. But that is going to be C, student organization policy revisions. Secretary JR.
Okay, so they're going around right now. I'm actually going to take vote and pass them around faster. I'm sorry.
policy by Secretary Auger and a second by Kim Clark. Secretary Auger, can you please explain the revisions?
Okay, so this policy, okay, this was the one that hasn't been revised since 1979, and Dr. Kane isn't here to try to clarify that. Anyway, so this policy hasn't been revised again since 1979. I'm gonna be honest, this policy was written on a typewriter and it wasn't even on a computer, so so after seeing the policy from 1979, we scrapped the whole thing pretty much and wrote a new one. Not necessarily. It's still the same policy, but it's way different.
Yeah.
Way different. The main thing that I want to focus on is the classification of clubs and organizations. The whole first section, the whole first article, numbers 1 through 8 were not, if they were there, they weren't defined, but most of these classifications weren't even in that policy. They had a classification and they listed them, but there was no definition for them, so we came up, myself as well as the student organization committee came up with definitions for them. This passed at SOC today, and this is, that's pretty much it for like classification. Everything is defined, and there's also examples of what those classifications are, like examples of student organizations that fit under that category. Funding criteria, we changed that because the funding criteria from 1979 stated that there was two parts to funding, initial funding and then full funding. That doesn't exist anymore. Organizational meetings wasn't even in there. That's direct verbatim from the SOC policy. Just stating that they may request a representative from the student organizations committee to organize their first meeting. Submission of membership statistics was not in there. That's just stating that groups need to submit rosters. Submission of organizational merits. This is the status reports that we get every year. We usually get them by the time of budget hearings, but we change that to say semi-annual status reports. So we get the initial status report during the first semester, and then the next status report at the time of budget hearings in February. February?
Yes.
Yes, okay. Roundtable meetings, that was not in there, so we put the portion about roundtable meetings and how student organizations need to go to roundtable meetings. And elections, I think there might have been a little section about elections, but now
just referred them to.
Yeah. For elections, we just referred them back to the Elections Commission policies and procedures. Procedures for impeachment, we just included that line about referring back to the organization's model constitution as the impeachment procedures are outlined in there. And items not covered in the constitution was already in this policy. That's pretty much the only thing we did not touch.
Any further? Oh, President Becker.
Oh, I
further discussion, all of those in favor of approving this policy, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, say no. Abstentions, motion passes. Congratulations, Dr.
Yes!
One policy.
That was one of the best high fives in Parliament history. We're going to move on to D, PFAC, Organization Model Constitution, from Secretary Ogden, who's passing it on. I don't have this.
Thanks for making that. Just saying.
fabulous job at the ribbon cutting ceremony for the Transportation Center earlier this morning. And he represented the students I guess represented President Pekia, did a terrific job there. Just so you know, I'm talking about the shuttle bus now. That the first 3 days last week for the shuttle bus, you might be interested that the the first day there were 99 riders on the shuttle bus. The second day there were 175 riders on the shuttle bus. And the third day, Friday, which is doesn't have as much activity on campus, I don't remember that number, but I think it was something like 64, something like that. So anyway, those first 3 days we seem to get off to a pretty good start. It helps to plan to do an activity like that when it's raining and snowing, right? Because people will ride the shuttle bus. So that worked out, and I'll get counts on a weekly basis for the rest of this semester from the company. But there have been several suggestions via email with me. I've shared those as appropriate with the two fellows that manage the company, and they have talked to the driver in a couple of cases and provided answers for me in a couple other cases. Anyway, it's a good cooperative venture, and I think all together it's working pretty well. That concludes my report, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. We're going to move on to the faculty update. Representative Dine.
Nobody wants.
Nobody wants. Representative Sarawati.
I don't know if this is the forum, but anyway, I'm going to make this update. Computer Science Education Week is celebrated in the first week of December, and there's an event on campus on December 5th. It's on a topic called Art Robotics, which is the intersection, I think, of art, computer science, and robotics. So if you guys have interest, you should show up there.
Thank you. We're going to move on to staff update. Mark Carlucci.
I have no updates, but I have one question. Is our last meeting for the semester, the 28th?
Yes, I think so.
And on holiday morning.
On the holiday. So yes, the meeting is
The last meeting is the 28th.
Yes.
Okay. So plan your schedule accordingly. Then it might be long.
The other students are here tonight, so we'll move on to alumni representative update. Very nice.
Alrighty, just two things. I know for once, and I'm not all hyped up on sugar this time, so you can understand me. First thing, I love the new bus shelter. I bused in today. It's basically a bus palace. I mean,
transportation center.
The transportation palace center. I'm serious. The heat, like you can turn the heat on yourself, the solar powered lights, the TVs. That is just wonderful. And SCG started that. One of my million roommates, Aaron Buckley, was really the spearhead of that. He is so proud and talks about it every day. He was looking forward to the day and wanted to say thanks for all the support. Wanted to let you guys know that. So very important. I pass on his regards. And the only other announcement I have goes all the way back, like, you know, 2 hours ago to when Kyla gave President Pecky a State of the Union, aka body, sorry. And when you said something about, you know, the positive intentions of people and seeking those out, because it's very important, that was a very important point you made. And there is a there's a pretty up-and-coming model in psychology, the Cartman drama in triangles, as it's called. And it all starts off with intuitive conflicts, and when you disagree with people, and when you have fights like over, when you're disagreeing on policies, it all goes back to whether or not you assume the person who came up with the problem or identified the problem had positive intentions with the solution. And it is next to impossible to come up with the right solution if you assume that the person who came up with the problem represented it with solutions or whatever, had negative intentions towards you or towards others. So I feel like as a body, we're really good about not doing that. So I just really wanted like you all to think about that, you know, as you're going through conflicts, like, I know, here we go. It's an organizational behavior thing. Like, you know, if you assume that the other person, like at work or in class or at school, like, you know, the person who raises the point and you just roll your eyes in class, like, what? Like, you know, that person isn't raising that point to be a jerk, probably. So, like, you know, think, like, where are they coming from? How can I communicate my point meaningfully? And we can arrive at a common ground and a solution. And hopefully things will go a little bit better. It does work. I've been using that for about 5-6 years now. Ultimately, like, being in the negative leads to, like, terrible things like blame and victimizing and trying to play the rescuer in a situation, and being on the top means being the leader. And so you can take charge or you can take blame. So ultimately you want to be taking charge, and I think we all took charge tonight, and we're getting better at playing SCG. So keep it up, guys. I love it. That's it.
Okay, thank you. We're gonna move on to appointments. Resignations and vacancies.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I have one. I have to expel Stephanie Gayamfi Darkwa from Parliament for excessive absences. And that's it.
That's all your issues?
Yep.
Okay, we're going to go on to issues of Parliament members. Everyone raise their card if they have an issue. Mm-hmm. We have Treasurer Day, we have Secretary Auger, we have Representative Rizmo. Anyone else? We have Vice President Costa. Anyone else? I have some remarks. Sassy Gallo. First, I'd like to say that I was very happy to be a part of the ceremony today. For anyone who really doesn't know, the Transportation Center that was recently created, that's what happens when students and administration work together. And I think that's very important, especially since we have a president, and President Cariello, President College, who was very happy to hear issues and concerns from students and always looking to improve the college. But, you know, improvements like that, improvements like the Rec Center, various improvements in Donovan, that's because students worked hard. Students came together, they saw issues, and they wanted to actually improve their campus. I hope that student community government, we only have one meeting this year, this semester, but I hope next semester, or maybe even our last meeting, I hope that we can come together on focusing on a specific issue that's actually going to improve this college. Larger issues, larger ideas. I don't think that this, I think this parliament is kind of restricting themselves in terms of kind of thinking outside the box. There's many issues that we can tackle this year, and I'm hoping that we do proceed to do that. Aaron Buckley was one of those students that always wanted to think outside the box and always wanted to really change his campus, and his issue was helping RIPA students. And there are students who need to be thankful for Aaron Buckley because he orchestrated the 50% discount to help many students commute to school. If they don't have a car, they could actually use public transportation, which we all know is the green way for society, and it definitely helps out our parking problem. And we need more of that Aaron Buckley energy, especially here on Parliament. And if people know Aaron Buckley, know what I'm talking about. I also want to talk about the funding policies and procedures. I really hope that there's a compromise. We obviously see it as two sides, and it's very close, especially here in Parliament. Those things are supposed to be taken care of committee, but if they need to be brought here in Parliament and brought back behind the scenes, well, this is why we're here to work behind closed doors. But I hope that influence outside Parliament isn't as strong as I believe it may be, because there was an agreement, and all of a sudden, a couple of minutes, you hear arguments and behind closed doors about this to the government, and that's not how an efficient government works. You really gotta come to compromises, you really gotta work within the committees if you have disagreements there. And be honest about what the problem is, because Jordan Day and President Pecchio are very serious this year in getting student community government financially where they need to be. And this is a problem, whether you like to admit it or not, whether your biases like to have you blind or not, this is a problem, we need to solve it. And it's always better to come to a compromise where everyone's issues are heard, where everyone's concerns are heard, and we actually come up with a nice solution that everyone can be agreed with. There's a fiscal problem, and we have to solve it. And they're being serious about it, and they're being honest about it. We need everyone on the table to do the same. That, thank you for a nice meeting. Take the gavel back. We're gonna move on to President Beckett.
Thank you, Speaker Escobar. I mean, you encapsulated everything I ever wanted to say in my whole life, so thank you. No, it's true. But, I mean, I apologize if discussion was dry for you guys, but, like, every week, we are consistently, my executive council is on the agenda, and if you don't contribute anything, then that's what it's going to be like. So I'm sorry if you didn't appreciate the discussion today, but you guys need to come up with some things. Here's a couple suggestions. Let's see. Wi-Fi was out in New Hall all of yesterday. That's an issue. That shouldn't be happening. And the only way you find out is if you log on and you can't get on Wi-Fi. And I went on my phone and they sent me an email telling me I have no Wi-Fi, which is super redundant. Why would you do that? That's ridiculous. Another thing, I threw out my glass in the back parking lot. We talked about it in the town hall meeting. Huge issue. I go out at least one, well, I go to my car like 3 times a week. Thankfully, I only work 3 times a week. But like, I see one flat tire every time I go out. And residents are afraid to pick up these bottles because you know they were alcoholic bottles. If you pick up the bottle in an RA season, you get in trouble. The same with the trash bins in the suite. People are getting fined for things that they are not doing, and it's ridiculous. So there are some ideas for you guys if you want to spearhead those campaigns, because I only have time for so many things, and we need some help over here. So thank you. That concludes my remarks.
Thank you, President Pankey. We move on to Treasurer Jordan Day.
I just want to say I'm disheartened by the conversations that the conversation and discussion had about the policy tonight. Personally, I mean, I know this wasn't intentional, and I maybe, this is what I said last week. We shouldn't be choosing sides. We should be looking at facts and figures and really what the cost and output is. So I plan on having a full report for you next meeting, about conferences, how much revenue is spent, which organization uses revenue, which organization is fundraise. That way you guys do have the full information in front of you, because I think having a policy in front of you that you don't fully understand isn't fair. And I didn't want to put this on the agenda tonight, blindsiding people and not having it emailed out, but it was approved in finance today with a lot of changes, and I felt that I had enough gusto to get it through tonight, and I was hoping for everybody to work together and have a positive discussion. But that was not the case. I ask all of my committee members, whether they disagree with me or not, to have a conversation with me, and I felt like that did not happen today. And I will point blank call out my finance members that are here. And this is something that you as Parliament can work on as well. If you have a concern about something that the Executive Council is bringing up, bring it up to them. If you have a question or a concern, bring it up to that respective chairperson. It does not do well to bombard them in Parliament with issues and concerns. I mean, we are here for discussion, and there are legitimate concerns that can't be addressed between two people. Duh. But there are concerns that could have been resolved before the policy had passed during finance, after the policy was passed during finance. I could have totally not put the policy on the agenda tonight at all if that was the case. I'm all for compromising. I'm all for working together. There are no such thing as sides. I said we were all here together to work for the students. I am here to work for the students. I made that very clear during my discussion, and I want to make that very clear again. I'm here for the students. I've worked harder for the students this year than I've ever worked in my entire life. I work harder for me every day than I've ever worked in my entire life. You all should be doing the same for yourselves. You're not doing any justice to yourselves if you're kowtowing to what other people tell you to do. You're not doing any justice to yourself if you're just believing what anybody tells you to. I am not the final say. We are the final say. And it disgusts me that other people are going around and not addressing the issues with the people who need to be addressed. I'm guilty of doing the same thing, and I'm going to make an effort to be better. We all should make a pledge today to be better, because we're better than this. We're student leaders, and we need to be more progressive than backdoor deals and backdoor discussion. I felt like I was blindsided today with some of the dissent, and I know some people are going to disagree with me. It's totally cool. I'm totally cool with that. Let me reiterate, I'm totally cool with it. But I want to repeat that it's important to me that we have an open discussion that's healthy. I didn't feel like tonight's discussion was healthy, and even on my end, I did get defensive, but I worked really hard on this policy, and I sat with 4 Executive Council members, myself included, Kyla, Gianna, and Hillary, and we worked on this policy, and not everybody was there for the full policy changes, but we worked together as a group. I would rather work together as a group and come to a compromise with 3 other people than work together by myself, and that's what I feel like I'm doing. I'm pushing against the grindstone, and I don't feel like I should be pushing against the grindstone. I feel like we should be working together, and we're not doing that, and I'm disgusted by that. So I want to make that point very clear tonight, that I plan to work better with everyone, but you need to plan to work better with me too. With that said, go on.
Okay, thank you, Treasurer Day. We'll move on to Secretary John Arbor.
Okay, so I'm going to stay after again for a couple minutes after the meeting. Let me know if you haven't already, if you're coming to the holiday party. Also, let me know if you have any food allergies. Let me know if you're going to have a vegetarian meal. Because I need to let our contact know how many plated vegetarian meals we're going to have, or if there's any special circumstances like food allergies that need to be accommodated for. Also, Food Services Advisory Committee, I say it like every other meeting, it's tomorrow, Donovan in the Veterans Center South Dining Room.
at 12:30. And I believe actually tomorrow that's gonna be the first meeting that I'm not at since I started working at Donovan. That's sad. Really sad. But yeah, no, I won't be there. I'll be working on my research paper that's due in psychology. So but that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Secretary Auger. I'm gonna move on to Representative Tomlin.
All right, five things. First off, to answer a question that was brought up in the whole conference revenue discussion, it is all funded student organizations that will be affected by the policy, not just a select few, because all have the ability to make 501, 502, and in my opinion, and I'm pretty sure this can be put forward as fact, 503 ad revenue. You may ask, how can Political Science Club make ad revenue? Well, who here was on like student council in high school, stuff like that? You go out and you sell, you know, banners for your events, all those little placemats, and you go to businesses and you ask those businesses for ads on those little things. I mean, I know we're in college now, but we can do that. And yes, student government facilitates that growth through budgeting to all clubs, because all clubs have office supply line items that ask for them. They can go out and make those things, and they have printing line items that can go out and make that, and they can go and you know, sell ads from to businesses to advertise with an organization. You know, communications club sponsored by Big Tony's throwing off this event. I mean, why not? I mean, the revenue is there for anyone. It's not just the media center. Its potential is there, and that's why I disagree with the sentiments there in the policy, because it does affect everyone, and everyone does have at least some opportunity, you know, especially in an organization like programming, which has, you know, basically two portions of its budget, has all the line items for events and the non-revenue events. Everything that's not non-revenue, you know, should be making revenue, at least somewhat. Now, granted, 10 years ago, all clubs had to make revenue. All had to make 5%. I believe, and that will not work. We ever have to go through that, because most clubs won't. They, again, do have the opportunity to, but I believe we're moving in the right direction on a financial state, especially without having to fund club sports like we have been, and stuff like that. And the fact that the student activity fee was raised from what it was in 2007 to what it is now, I don't believe we have to go back to that. I believe not for another more 20, you know, two decades or whatever. But, you know, the opportunity is there for all clubs to raise revenue. Some have it easy, it's just the nature of the business. You know, life isn't fair, it is the way it is. You know, there's certain mediums that work. The media center basically is the PBS of campus. It's funded by the government. Granted, it's not state run, in the sense that they can print what they want, because there's the First Amendment doesn't just apply to outside of the college. The First Amendment also applies to what gets printed in the newspaper and stuff like that. And they're not, you can create a competing TV station, radio station. Granted, we're probably not big enough to have that. You can create a competing newspaper, and I believe there is one right now that's in the works. Whatever it is. So that's my main point right there. And yes, compromises can be made, and I do wish for more discussions with members of Parliament and the Executive Board. I know myself and Treasurer Day had a discussion last Wednesday.
I'm tracking you.
All right. That's that. Maybe I might not get all five, because, you know, we do have a lot to talk about, and when I was first on Parliament, these meetings used to go to like 11:30 every week. Now, granted, we just talked around in circles, so maybe that wasn't effective, but people, you know, should talk like this, like everyone here. And it brings me to another issue, less reactive policy. Every year that I've been either on Parliament or not on Parliament, or on this campus, or as a full-time student or part-time student, you know, president of a big organization, or just a treasurer of a chess club, whatever, lost that election. But less reactive policy. Every year we change the funding policies. We don't change student organization policies. We don't change the adjudication policies. You know, less reactive. Don't just because, you know, the anchor went on the conference and they spent a lot of revenue, meaning we have a change it this year for next year or immediately. I mean, give it some time. Let the system work for it itself. Eventually, it will fix itself because I believe we have the most effective student government in the country. I mean, biggest, most organized, most well-funded, given the size of the college. Another point is I think we need to push for the expansion of the student union. That could put in the back burner, basically for political reasons, because the college wanted to push for its academic buildings instead of the opportunity of question three. Fantastic that that passed, but as students, as a commuter at large representative, if I didn't have positions in organizations, I would still have nowhere to go except in a library in Donovan, because those purple chairs out there, I don't want to sit in there all day. I just don't. It's not appealing to me as a student. I'm sorry, and I love, Kristen and Mark. You know, they do a great job managing the building, but I know they want to see, the potential that this building could be with a bigger renovation. Because I was involved, I went on the student union tour that Kristen Salemi put together last year, and I saw what Eastern Connecticut State had. Their college, roughly our size, and they basically used to have a brick building like this, an old shoe factory, to quote Don Temcher when he used to talk about the rec center. It's okay. This building could be so much better if the students just push for it, and I know members of the administration wants it, and it should be better. It's serving what it is right now, but it could serve so much better. So I think this body needs to advocate for a student union. Another thing, thank you to our state-run media for showing up. We don't force them to, but it's nice that they do. Anchor TV, the anchor, the buoy, the editor-in-chief, even though it's unofficial, it was here. It is what it is. It's competition, like it or not. Jared Ware, new sports talk director of WXIN, I'm sure highlights from this parliament meeting will be in the news brief for the DJs to read. At least they better be. Down there. And, I said five, kind of brushing all together, but am I at last one?
No.
All right. So that's all I have to say.
Thank you for your remarks. Yes, we do need to expand the union. Vice President Costa, you're the last on this list, and I see your last on the list.
It looked like you were looking at it.
No, that was a little bit too much. Let's go.
Okay. On a lighter note, with the recent expulsion presented by Secretary President Pecchia, a commuter at large seat is now open. And I'm saying that to the camera and to those out there who may be watching. A commuter at large seat is now open, and it's one of the easiest seats to acquire for student government. So we should have that immediately filled. I mean, we don't have another meeting for another 2 weeks. That's ample opportunity for them to get the signatures to get on Parliament. So I best see a face between now and the end of the week in my office to take out that petition. With that, I motion to adjourn.
Second.
Motion to adjourn by Vice President Costa, second.